exercise 23. So we were looking at the group of exercise 21, and exercise 22 also involved that group. So now in that group we are going to define a subset. If you want to recall what that group was, it was defined to be the set of all functions of the form tau a comma b, where a is non-zero. It is that group. It forms the group under composition of mappings. We have already seen that. Okay, so now in this group we have the subset consisting of those functions where the first real number is 1. Okay, so 1 is non-zero, so it's a subset of G. Now we have to prove that it's a subgroup of G. Clearly, N is non-empty. In fact, we will not mention it anymore, unless it's not obvious that the given subset is non-empty. This is the last time we are mentioning it. From now on, whenever we are required to show that a subset is a subgroup, in most of the cases where non-emptiness is easy to verify, we won't even mention it. Okay, so let tau 1 comma b1 and tau 1 comma b2 be two elements in N, where it is understood that b1 and b2 are real numbers. Then what do we get when we compose them? We have already found the formula for this composition. So it is 1 times 1 comma b1 times 1 plus b2. So this is equal to tau 1 b1 plus b2, and this again belongs to N. And what is the inverse of this? Inverse of this by definition is the, I mean not by definition but by what we have found previously, is minus b1 divided by 1, which is tau 1 comma minus b1, and this again belongs to N. Hence N is a subgroup of G. Okay, next we have to prove this thing. Let tau a comma b be any element in G, and tau 1 comma c be in N. Then inverse. This is equal to, we can calculate this product first, and at the same time we can also write the expression for this inverse. So this one will be a times 1, that is a, b times 1 plus c, that is b plus c, and the inverse is 1 by a minus b by a. Now we can calculate this composition. So this will be tau of a times 1 by a comma b plus c times this minus b by a. So because a is non-zero, a times 1 by a is 1, and there is a bug. Oh, I hope I did not lose the focus. Let me see. No, it's okay. So this is 1 comma b by a minus b by a will cancel out and we will be left with c by a. So this again belongs to n, and that's what we wanted to show. So this is a rather easy computational exercise. So the solution ends here. Okay, now next we come to a start problem. Let G be a group a finite group actually whose order is not divisible by 3. Suppose that AP whole cube equals A cube B cube for all A and B in G. Prove that G must be abelian. Okay. So it is given that G is a finite group whose order is not divisible by 3. Because 3 is prime, it means that the order of G and 3 are relatively prime. Okay. And additionally, it's given that this equation is true for all elements A and B of G. Then we have to prove that G is abelian. So let us see how we can get the solution. Since every group of order 1 is abelian, so we can assume that G has order at least 2. Since every group of order 1 means there is only one element, the identity element, is abelian, we assume this. That means in our group there is at least one non-identity element. Since 3 does not divide order of G, the greatest common divisor of the order of G and 3 is 1. And so there exist integers alpha comma beta such that alpha times order of g plus 3 beta is equal to 1. Okay, so this we have from the relative primality of order of g and 3. Okay, now let a and b be any elements in g. Then how can we write AB whole cube by definition is AB times AB times AB. A cube B cube is equal to AB AB AB. Now you can, if you look at this, if you concentrate between the outermost A and B, in the middle you see BA BA. So that means A BA square B. Which implies A cube can be written as A times A square, B cube can be written as B square times B using the rules of exponent. So this is equal to A times B A whole square B. Now we can cancel A from both sides using the left cancellation law, and we can cancel B from both sides using the right cancellation law. So by the cancellation laws, A square B square is equal to B A whole square. Okay. A square B square is equal to B A whole square. Similarly, B square A square is equal to AB whole square, because A and B are arbitrary, so we can interchange A and B. They are arbitrary elements of the group. Hence, now what happens if we try to calculate B cube A square? B cube A square can be written as B times B square A square. Now using this identity, we get B times AB whole square. Now AB whole square, if we expand, then it will be AB AB along with the first B that we already have. But now if we concentrate on the first four terms, that is BA BA. So this is nothing but B A whole square B. But B A whole square is actually equal to A square B square. B. So this becomes A square B cube. So B cube A square is equal to A square B cube. A square and B cube commute with each other. And this implies what does this imply? A square is equal to, we can write b to the power minus 3 also first or on that side. On both sides of this equation, b cube a square is equal to a square b cube. You multiply by b to the power minus 3 from the left hand side. Doing that to this term gives us b square, because b cube, b to the power minus 3 and b cube will give us identity. On this side we have b to the power minus 3. Hence a square is equal to b to the power minus 3 a square b cube. In place of this a square, you can again substitute this expression, that is, you can do this a square b cube, and outside we also have b cube. So we have b to the power minus 6 a square b to the power 6, and you can do that again. A square b cube b to the power 6, that will give you, oh sorry, this is b to the power minus 6, b to the power minus 9 a square b cube, b to the power 9, 3 plus 6, and it goes on and on until or till you get to the point where you have this 3 times beta. 3 times beta means 3 times absolute value of beta, actually. A square. The question is how? How are we getting? Here you see, we are actually getting multiples of 3, right? Here we have 3 times 1, 3 times 1. 3 times 2, 3 times 2, 3 times 3, 3 times 3. So that means the multiples will increase. Shall we get to this absolute value of beta? We will get, provided beta is non-zero. If beta is a non-zero integer, then its absolute value is a positive integer. So because in this calculation, in this sequence of steps, we are hitting all multiples of 3. So at one stage we will hit this particular multiple of 3. The question is beta non-zero? And the answer is yes, and the justification is this. Note that beta is non-zero because order of g is greater than 1. If beta is equal to 0, then alpha times order of g becomes equal to 1. But since alpha and order of g are both integers, so each one of them is either plus 1 or minus 1, because they need to divide 1. However, order of g can never be a negative integer. So we are then forced to conclude that order of g has to be equal to 1. But since we have already assumed order of g is greater than 1, so we cannot have beta equal to 0, because otherwise we will get a contradiction. That's why beta is a non-zero integer, and so absolute value of beta is a positive integer, and we will hit this multiple of 3 at some stage after a finite number of steps. Okay. But now what do we get? If beta is greater than 0. Then suppose beta is greater than 0, then in place of absolute value of beta we will get beta itself. Then a square is equal to b to the power minus 3 beta times a square times b to the power 3 beta. Now we can use this equation. Using this equation we will get this equal to, in place of minus 3 beta we will have alpha times order of g minus 1, so b to the power alpha times order of g minus 1 a square, and here we will have the negative of that, that means 1 minus alpha times order of g. Now we can freely use rules of exponent. We can write it like this, to the power alpha times b to the power minus 1 times a square. Okay, these times should not be written because there is the binary operation. Okay, we have already decided to not write any symbol for it. A dot b has been replaced by ab. On this side, I mean for this one, b to the power 1, b to the power order of g to the power minus alpha, sorry. Okay. Now b to the power order of g, according to the second corollary to Lagrange's theorem, is equal to the identity. So these two terms will not be there. That means, will not be there means they will be identity, so they will vanish. So we will be left with this, a square b. Okay. So this is the conclusion if beta is greater than 0. If beta is less than 0, then b to the power, this will become 3 beta because now absolute value of beta will be minus beta, a square, and this will become minus 3 beta. So looking at the previous calculation, we can now directly write, in place of, if we have 3 beta, then for that one we have b. If we have minus 3 beta, then we have b inverse. So that means here we will have b a square b inverse. Or, so a square is equal to b a square b inverse, or you can pre-multiply both sides by b inverse, post-multiply both sides by b. Doing that, you will get b inverse a square b is equal to a square. So in any case, we are getting a square is equal to b inverse a square b, a square is equal to b inverse a square b. Thus, in any case, a square is equal to b inverse a square b, or b a square is equal to a square b. Okay, so we have got something like this. Now finally, so b a a b, if we calculate now the product BAAB. Using associative law, we can write it like this: B A square B. This A will join with, can be joined with that AB to make it A square B. But A square B is the same as B A square. So this is equal to B A square. In place of A square B, we have written B A square. Again, using associative law, we have B square A square. But we have already proved that B square A square is AB whole square. So this is AB whole square, and which again can be written as AB times AB. Now you look at the first and last terms of this equations: BA times AB, AB times AB. So we can, using the right cancellation law, we can cancel AB from both sides. Thus, by the right cancellation law, BA equal to AB. This shows that A and B commute with each other, but A and B were any elements of G, so all elements of G commute with one another. Hence, G is abelian. Okay, so that's how we get the conclusion that the group is abelian. Next exercise 25. This one is also starred. Let G be an abelian group. So here the group is given to be abelian, and suppose that G has elements of order, I need ink. G has elements of orders M and N respectively. Prove that G has an element whose order is the LCM of M and N. Is the least common multiple of M and N. Okay, let So there are elements in G of orders m and n, where m and n are some positive integers. So we consider A and B to be such elements, such that order of A is m and order of B is n. Now before we handle the general case where the LCM of m and n can be anything, we look at the particular case that it will be useful, where m and n are relatively prime, so that their product is their LCM. Assume first that the GCD of m and n is equal to 1. In this case, their LCM is nothing but their product. Our aim now is to show that the element whose order will be this, the element we are seeking, is nothing but the product AB. AB will have order MN. Now we want to prove that. Okay. Now since G is abelian, we have AB to the power MN. Okay. Abelianness of G allows us to write it like this. It is true in an abelian group that if you take the nth power of any product, then you can distribute the exponent among all the factors, like what we have done here. Now we further use rules of exponent to write the thing like this. Now A to the power m is identity because m is the order of A. Just like that, b to the power n is the identity. So this is equal to identity. So the mnth power of AB actually becomes equal to the identity. What this tells us is that the order of AB is at most mn, because by definition it has to be the least positive integer for which the corresponding power equals the identity. Now this is a power which equals the identity, so the order will be less than or equal to mn. Okay. Now let K be a positive integer such that AB whole to the power K is equal to identity. If we can show that K is greater than or equal to MN, then it proves that MN is the least positive integer for which the corresponding power is equal to the identity, and our job will be done. And we now aim to show that. Then if this is what we have assumed, then the identity E can be written as E to the power M. Oh, there is quite a calculation here that needs to be done. Okay, let us do it carefully. AP, okay, E to the power M. Now in place of this E, we replace with AB all to the power K. using rules of exponent, this is ab to the power kn. And because the group is abelian, just like what we have done here, we can write this product like this: a to the power km times b to the power km. Okay, now m is already the order of a, so we can make use of that fact after writing this power like this. So this is equal to e to the power k times b to the power km, which is equal to b to the power km. So we see that b to the power km is equal to the identity, right? So that means this is a positive integer for which the corresponding power of b is equal to the identity. So the order of b, which is n, actually by just the definition of order, n should be less than or equal to km, but something more is true. N not only is less than or equal to km, but n in fact divides km. This is a result we haven't seen yet. Result means it's a short result. We will see this in exercise 36.